And I'll fly away down there and have too.
Check, one, two.
Jerry, I don't know where you'll be up here this morning. Is she coming?
Hey, it's 10:03. We need to be playing some.
Amen. It's time to start church this morning. Amen. Amen. It's good to see everybody this morning. Good to be back in the house of God this morning. Amen. We've got Jesus on the main line. Y'all stand and sing with us.
Jesus on the main line, get what you want. Jesus on the main line, just get what you want. Yes, Jesus on the main line, get what you want. Jesus on the main line now.
Why don't you call him up, call him up?
Get what you want. Call him up, yes, call him up. Get what you want. Yes, call him up,
on that main line now. Well, that same spirit that raised Jesus will take me home someday. Oh, he said it was expedient. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And what a day that will be. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, there is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, and no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace. Over there. upon his face. Oh, the one that saved me by such grace. And he takes me by the hand. Yes, leads me through the promised land. Oh, what a day, a glorious day. Church, amen. What a day that will be. The Jesus that come to this earth and died for each and every one of us, amen. We get to look upon that face. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, this morning. We're going to sing some hymnals also. Grab your book this morning. Turn to page 110. We're going to do Heaven's Jubilee. Page 110.
Thank you, Lord. Glory to the Lamb. Thank you, Father.
Some glad morning we shall see Jesus in the air. He's coming after you and me, the joy's ours to share. Now what rejoicing there will be when the saints shall rise. They're headed for that jubilee, it's yonder in the sky. Now oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. One of these days. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Turn back to page 319. Amen. When the redeemed are gathering in. Amen. I'm thinking of that rapture. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
I am thinking of the rapture in our blessed home on high when the redeemed are gathering in. We'll raise a heavenly anthem in that city in the sky when the redeemed are gathering in. Yes, when the redeemed are gathering in and washed like snow and free from sin. Over on the streets of gold when the redeemed are gathering in. Oh, what music, oh, what singing, oh, that city will be rolled when the redeemed are gathering in.
victory deed, our gathering in, and watch like snow and green proceed, and have a shout, and have a speed. Victory deed, our gathering in. Saints will sing redemption stories with their voices clear and strong. Victory deed, our gathering in. Some glad morning, I'm going to fly away. Amen. 333. Amen. Well, some glad morning, yes, when this life is over, I'm going to fly away. Now to a home on those God's celestial shore. Praise this morning, amen. Amen. If you are redeemed, One of these days, we're going to fly away. Amen. Jesus said he's coming back after his church, and I'm excited for that day. Amen. Amen. Y'all may be seated this morning if you like. Amen. Ushers take their places to take our Sunday morning tithes and offering. Amen. It's good to see everybody. It's good to see the Hubbards with us this morning. Amen. Amen. Good to see all of our visitors out there. Amen. Good to see you this morning. Our numbers are a little bit down, but this is the holiday weekend, so we've got some out on the road. We can just pray that God would bless them and be with them. We miss our drummer over there this morning. God, just be with them as they're traveling and enjoying this weekend and their time off. And we just want to uplift them and protect them. For God to bless them this morning as well. Ashton was set up to sing this morning, but he's got a little bit of nasal stuff going on, and he decided he's going to step down and not sing this morning. But you're welcome to come up and help me if you want to. So he said, "Dad, can you do it this morning for me?"
Big old football player.
Yeah, he said just not this morning. So, amen. So we're going to try this one. This was the last minute get together. So give me some words up there, and we're going to try to do it this morning. Amen. A lot of times we think about how small we are in the great grand scheme of things, but Jesus always has a hand in it, has his hand upon us, and he wants to know what we're going through, and who am I, amen, that the Lord of all this earth would care to know my name, amen. Thank you, Lord. Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name and care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Amen. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again? Who am I that that voice that calmed the seas could call out through the rain and calm a storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, it's because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a paper in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I am yours. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, I'm yours. Hallelujah. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. Oh, I am yours. I am yours. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? Cause I am yours, I am yours. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that promise this morning. Amen. Amen. Give him a hand clap of praise. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I am yours this morning. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Amen. Remember the names on our prayer request sheet this morning, Sister Martha. God continue working and ministering to her this morning. Pray for Bobby Owens. That's Sister Linda's brother. God would continue to bless him and strengthen him. And Don Higgins as well. Brother Bobby Hopp, I don't see them here this morning. Let's continue to uplift them. Sister Tammy Baker, continuing to seek God for healing in her eyes as well. Sister Sue Snyder, Sandra Beth Moon. Remember these requests this morning, as well as Brother John's neighbor in Coal Hills, John? Jim. Brother Jim, that God would bless him, going through some things there. So let's up with Jim this morning and let God bless and work in his life. Amen. Do y'all have any prayer requests this morning? Unsaved loved ones, maybe someone in the hospital, some needs a touching spirit, touching body. Amen. God sees those hands this morning. Amen. We'll go for blessings. God would minister to them as well. Those that's watching on live stream this morning, the prayers and the requests that they might have this morning as well. Remember our shut-ins, those that are unable to make it to church and stuff like they used to. I'm sure they want to be here, but God bless them and be with them where they are and touch them, give them peace. Bless those that's not here this morning, like we said earlier, those that's on the road, those that are unable to that have gone and to enjoy this long weekend. God bless them. Give them traveling mercies. Amen. And pray for our military personnel, our firemen, our emergencies that drives ambulance, things like that. God bless them and be with them. You know, we can't give them enough recognition for the things that they do, that they put themselves in harm's way each and every day. We just pray that God would bless them and be with them and touch them this morning. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, we're going to go to the Lord and song here, and then we're going to pray for these needs this morning. Amen. Thankful that we're on holy ground. Thank you, Jesus. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is here, and where holy, that's right, and these are holy hands, we're lifting up holy hands, for the Lord is here, and where he is holy, and we standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around, so let us pray. Jesus, now holy ground. I believe that this morning, don't you? Let's go to the Lord in prayer for these needs. Father God, we do just thank you. We do praise you, Lord, for your presence, Lord. Let us not ever take for granted, God, the presence of the Lord in this place. God, you said where two or three are gathered together, that you are there in the midst, Lord Jesus. Thank you for that promise this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you said you'd never leave us nor forsake us, God, and we praise you, God. We just ask, Lord Jesus, God, as we come humbly before your throne, Lord, God, that you administer to these needs, Lord Jesus. God, each and every one of these names that we've called out this morning, Father God, we pray that you would work in their life, Lord, in a special way, Lord God, whether they need healing, Lord Jesus, whether they need a financial touch, Lord, whether they need, God, just an uplifting, Lord Jesus, a friend to lean upon, Lord, whatever it may be. God, I pray for them, Lord Jesus, this morning. God, I pray your special touch, Lord. God, would just come down from heaven, minister to them, speak into their life, Lord Jesus, and turn around their situation, Lord. God, I praise you, and I thank you, Lord, that you have answered prayer, that you're going to do those things this morning, God. Bless these names, Lord Jesus, God. God, touch Jim, Lord Jesus. God, touch these names, Lord. Touch Sister Martha, Lord. Bless them, God. God, touch Bobby Owens, Lord Jesus, God. God, we pray for Don Higgins, Lord Jesus, this morning. God, we uplift Bobby Hop, Lord. Bless our brother, Lord Jesus. God, touch Sister Tammy, Lord Jesus. God, bless her, Lord. We thank you, God, for it. Sue Snyder, Lord, we pray and we uplift her this morning, Lord Jesus. Sandra Beth, Lord, touch her and minister to her this morning, God. Bless those, Lord Jesus, in the military, God. Every branch, Lord Jesus, may your hedge of protection be around him, Lord Jesus. God, minister to them, Lord. Just like you had your hedge of protection around Job, Lord. God, and the devil wanted to come in and try to steal, but he couldn't do anything as long as that hedge was there. God, we pray that around our church, around our family, around those of that put themselves in harm's way. God, and around this country, Lord, may your hedge of protection be there, Lord Jesus, protecting each and every one of us, Lord. God, we pray for those, Lord Jesus, in office, Lord, that make decisions, God, that affect our country and each and every one of us, God. I pray your anointing, Lord Jesus, would fall in that place, Lord. I pray that you would touch those individuals, Lord Jesus, God, that makes those decisions, Lord. God, I pray that they would seek your counsel, Lord, God, and they would... Lord Jesus, get on their knees, Lord, and change, God, the direction of this country. Lord, we just pray that you would help us just now, God, and we thank you for that. We praise you, God. Bless our shut-ins, Lord. Minister to them, God. Touch them and keep them this morning. God, those online watching, Lord, I pray, if there be one tonight, Lord Jesus, that needs a touch from you, Lord, God, we're agreeing with you. We're agreeing that God is going to touch that situation. We thank you for it this morning. Lord, we praise you for the spirit that we feel here this morning. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, that we are on holy ground. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, this is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is here, and where he is holy, and these are holy. Worship him this morning, church. We're lifting up holy hands. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, God. Fill this room, Lord, with your presence, Lord, once more, God. Thank you, Jesus. This is holy ground. Thank you, Lord. Worshiping church. Give him praise. Amen. He's heard our prayers this morning. He's working just now. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we're standing on holy ground. And I know that there are angels all around. Church, yes, Jesus now, and we are standing in his presence on holy ground. are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Well, let us pray. Well, Jesus, now, and we are standing in His presence on holy ground.
Thank you. Lift your hands to the Lord just one moment and love on Him. That's why we're here. We're here to bless Him, not ourselves. But we're here to bless the one who redeemed us and carried us through such difficulty of times and challenges. I want to bless Him. I want to lift Him up. He is worthy. He is the Almighty and the Great I Am. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Master. Yes. You owe me nothing, but I owe you everything, yes, O Lord. Yes, I owe you my breath. Yes, I owe you my life. I owe you my being. I owe you everything, Amen. Living God. And I want to honor you this day for giving us this moment and this time of privilege to glorify you in this earth. You, hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lord our God. Thank you, Master. Thank you, thank you for redeeming us, my Father and God. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. Would everybody say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Is He not awesome? Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God bless you. Amen. Thank you, choir. Thank you, Brother Keith. Give these folks a great big appreciation this morning. Amen. Our children's church is going to head on over and be blessed by Sister Elaine. We thank God for her and taking up time and patience and loving on our children. Thank God for people who care and love. Amen. Oh, we got BGMC, don't we? Thank you for reminding me of that. They're standing back there waving, waving. Got to get my attention. Amen. Got to get your change, your Coke money, your honey bun money, your mad money and all that stuff. Amen. They're going to play us a little music. Fill up those buddy barrels. Can you do that? Amen. Hallelujah. My part-timers is in here today. Hallelujah. Well, thank you, Master.
I want y'all to rise from your seats now, please, and join us.
Well, now this is a lot of mine. Yeah, I'm gonna let it shine. Well, now this is a lot of mine. Yeah, I'm gonna let it shine. Well, now this is a lot of mine. Yeah, I'm gonna let it shine.
Every day,
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 every day, every day. Gonna let my little light shine.
Jesus gave me the light.
many got a little light? How many got a bigger light? How many got a great light? Hallelujah! I'm telling you, that's what we are to do as God's people. Let it shine. Amen? Give the Lord a hand to you, will you? Hallelujah! Woo! Hallelujah! Now, I got a smartphone, but it didn't know what to do with all that. Amen. So glad to have you in the house of the Lord this morning. Thank God for our children. Thank you, parents and grandparents, for bringing children to the church. Amen. That tells them it's important. Amen. I appreciate, you know, the fact that we get to minister to kids. Sometimes parents drop them off in the time pass, but it's a whole lot better if a parent brings them and lets that shine through. Is that not true? And I am thankful that God gives us that as his people. Hallelujah. So glad to have you today. This is the first Sunday of September. Can you believe we've spent 8 months of 2023? It's gone. It's out of here. We're in the next 4 months that are going to be busy. It gets kind of... I'm on. Y'all just didn't hear me. Ah, now the PA system got saved. It's on too. You have to overlook me. Sometimes I get carried away. Hard to imagine that, ain't it? Can I tell you I'm excited about serving God? Amen. You know, I went the other night to one of those old pigskin fallouts football game. And I watch people out there, supposed to be smart and intelligent people, act very unlearned. Now, there were a few there that act pretty good, but I'm sitting there watching folks, and I like to watch people and things, and it's all right. I mean, I like to go. I like to watch these young boys playing, you know, out there. Man, they're... When I get to the house of God, I want the devil to know I ain't playing. I said, I ain't playing. I realize ain't what we're not supposed to use, but let me tell you, Webster invented words, and so can I.
And so I learned a long time ago, God brought me in this thing in a shout. He's going to take me out with a shout. I'm going to go all the points in between with a shout, a voice that says to him, thank you, thank you, thank you for loving me so much. Amen? I'm going to get to the word in just a minute. We found ourselves praying all along this trail. Lord, show me how to love you. I was praying one day and I said, Lord, I love you. I love you. And he said to me, how much do you love me, Kendricks? And I said, well, I don't know. I learned when God asks you a question, be honest and smart and say, I don't know. Because God doesn't ask you a question to get you to give him an answer. God asks you a question to let you get him to answer you. Because it's his answer that counts. And so I said, Lord, I don't know. He said, that's exactly correct. He said, until I test your love, you will never know how much I love you. And so I was praying again this morning, Lord, I want to love you more than I ever have. Show me how to love you. And at that very instant, I believe he dropped this thought in my heart. He said, inasmuch as you love the least, my son, of these that I gather together, you're loving me. You know how I love God more? I love on you. And I love on those that I don't even see right now. I love that. God says he equates that and writes that down in my memoir, in my journal, you know, in my diary in heaven. He writes that down. John Kendricks loved me by loving this person here and loving this person here. He showed me how to love him by loving the people that the world rejects. Oh, my gosh. Thank you, Lord. I'm so glad for him, aren't you? I know you're glad to be here. Thank you again for making this time very special today. And we're looking forward. This is a holiday weekend. If your time includes travels from here forward, please drive careful, because I'm going to tell you, there are a lot of nuts out there that's not hanging on a tree. Sad to say, many of them are behind steering wheels. And have you ever noticed people don't get in a hurry till they get in an automobile? Have you found yourself like that? You don't get in a hurry till you get in that car. Okay, I'm going to quit meddling. I'm going to go to the Word. Galatians 5, would you turn there and find that with me? Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm excited for the things that God is speaking into our midst and saying. Thank you for your enthusiasm, church. You have blessed Sister Kendricks and I beyond measure. We want to say thank you for the prayers. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for all the things you do. Let me tell you something. Smiling at somebody is a wonderful thing. It really is. And, you know, if we're going to church, we ought to go to church with a smile. And we ought to leave with a smile. Amen. And I believe you do that so well here. And thank you so much for welcoming others that come in and share this time with us, that it's so special. We want it to be special. Galatians chapter number 5. That's in the New Testament. If you want to figure out where that is, there's a little saying that kind of helps you put things in order. Go eat popcorn. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. Go eat popcorn. I won't charge y'all for that one. Is that all right? Galatians 5. Today I want to talk about, I like irony. I like contrast. I like analogies. That's how I'm wired. That's just how I am. I just, you know, we got started about 3 minutes after 10, and I told part of the choir up here, I said, this morning we're like a little baby with his diaper off running across the floor. We're a little behind. Forgive me. Y'all noticed I stepped over there to say that. Galatians 5, I want to begin reading at verse 10. I want to talk about becoming a slave to freedom. Becoming a slave to freedom. Paul said this, I'm trusting the Lord, and I'm reading from the NLT at this particular point. I am trusting the Lord to keep you from believing false teachings. God will judge that person, whoever he is, who has been confusing you. How many knows there's always somebody in the crowd that wants to mess up people's minds? Paul was dealing with that as he was ministering the gospel. He found some naysayers out there and some old religious hardliners that wouldn't let go of some things in spite of what God was revealing. Verse 11, dear brothers and sisters, if I were still preaching that you must be circumcised, as some say I do, why am I still being persecuted? If I were no longer preaching salvation through the cross of Christ, no one would be offended. So I just wish that those troublemakers who want to mutilate you by circumcision would mutilate themselves. Whew, that's a little insight. Paul was a little frustrated. He says, you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. I want to read that one more time. Don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. How many in here got a sinful nature? 1, 2, 3. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. King James said it like this, by love serve one another. For the whole law can be summed up in this one command. Love your neighbor as who? Love your neighbor, not your neighbor's spouse. Love your neighbor as yourself. What a revelation. Father, help us to digest what you have imparted already from the throne of heaven. We're here to respond to the wooing and the channeling of your mighty, awesome power and the words that you breathe in our midst today. Thank you. For the men and women, the dads, the moms, the sons, the daughters that have availed themselves of this particular time in worship to bless you and to honor you. Now, Father, give us ears to hear what the Holy Ghost says into our midst that we may receive, retain, and apply to bring glory to your name. It's in Jesus' glorious and mighty name that we praise you. And all God's people saying, amen and amen. You may be seated if you would like. God bless you. Paul, being challenged as he writes some great things to the church of Galatia, the elements of the law have crept back in, and it's causing problem for new believers in this collection of saints. So he wants to give them something that's going to help them in their daily walk as they live for the Lord. This is what we purpose to accomplish for and with you anytime we're ministering the Word of God. A few years ago, matter of fact, a lot of years ago, 1868, 1894, William Gladstone was Prime Minister in the UK. And he took that and he was a liberal. He done a lot of things during his tenure that was really contrary to the gospel and contrary to some other things. But as he was in his place as prime minister, they had a tragedy. There was a princess who died, Princess Alice, who passed away. And he wanted to give them a little bit of an analogy as that happened. So he told them a story about the princess. And he said she had, of course, you know, her family. She was the mother of seven, Princess Alice was. And she became seriously ill with diphtheria. But the way that happened was her children, out of her seven children, four of them came down with diphtheria. She was away a lot on business, taking care of matters of the kingdom in which she was serving in. And as she was away, she got news that her youngest, Marie, daughter, was very sick, and she needed to come home. The child had requested her mother, so Princess Alice made her way. You know, travel back during that time wasn't as fluid as it is today, but she made her way. But before she was able to get to her daughter with diphtheria choked and died. Very young, 5 years old or so that this young child died. She still had three other children that had diphtheria. Her youngest son was a part of that. And as she came in, the doctors had already warned her and other people, you do not have physical contact with people who have diphtheria. But as she got there to that house and her baby girl had already died, now her son is greatly stricken, and he's coughing, he's gagging, he's struggling for breath. And he said, Mommy, can you please hold me and kiss me? And without even thinking anything about it, Princess Alice grabbed that young boy, held him to her bosom, and she gave him a kiss on the cheek. And without even thinking anything, and she nurtured him to try to keep him from passing away from that disease. And so they made it through that time, but a little over 30 days later, Princess Alice got diphtheria, and she died, leaving her other children who were there as orphans because her husband had already passed away. And it was a terrible tragedy that struck that family. But you see, what I wanted to tell you that for was real love forgets about self. Real love doesn't examine what the danger truly is. Real love will not count the cost. Real love acts. The Bible says many waters cannot quench love in Psalms 128. The floods cannot drown it. Being a slave to freedom will always surpass the roadblocks that logic has thrown up in our way. How many is glad for some real love in the house? May 2nd, 1962, there was an advertisement that run in San Francisco newspaper, and this particular lady was making a plea. Her husband had been falsely accused of a crime, of someone's death, a murder, and the name was Kidd, K-I-D-D. And her husband was incarcerated. They had him up on first-degree murder, and the trial was coming up. Well, Mrs. Kidd ran an ad in the paper. She said, I don't want my husband to be executed for a crime he did not commit. I will therefore offer my services for 10 years as a cook, as a maid, as a housekeeper to any leading attorney who will defend him and vindicate him in his charges. One of San Francisco's very well-known attorneys got wind of the ad. And he stepped up, he contacted Mrs. Gladys Kidd and said, I will take the case. And so he did. And through investigation, he was able to prove, amen, this particular thing. See what had happened? They had a sword with Mr. Kidd's blood on this sword, and they believe that was the sword that took the storekeeper's life. But the attorney proved that the sword wasn't the culprit that took the man's life. It was, in fact, a particular knife. And the only reason Mr. Kidd's blood was on there, he had been in the store and he had been messing around with somebody else and had accidentally cut himself with a sword. You know how it is when men play with things. And so the inevitable pursued that source of events, and now he's up, but yet the attorney proved that Mr. Kidd was not guilty of the crime. 11 hours of a deliberation that the jury stayed in, but they came out vindicating Mr. Kidd and set him free. Mr. Kidd was so grateful. Miss Gladys was ready to do her part and serve the attorney, but the attorney came to her and said, I will not require your services. I was glad to serve you, madam. Becoming a slave to freedom will bring you to a place that everybody else thinks you are crazy and not in your right mind. But God is looking for people who become slaves to freedom. What kind of freedom? Whom the Son makes free is? We, the church, sometimes live below our privilege where that is. And we need the Word of God to stir us up and to help us in this journey. So the purpose for any task by the world standard is this. You work to get money. You work for compensation. You work for wages. That is what it used to be the way our world functioned. Now, it's like this. Can I get on my disability? Don't take offense to me. We had an 18-year-old in our church that we pastored between here and Jerusalem. Y'all know where that is? Is there a Jerusalem in Arkansas? It wasn't that one. And we had an 18-year-old in that church, and they reached that age, 18, and I heard him say, I want to go draw my disability. I said, well, you won't draw disability. You didn't pay one nickel in. Well, the government owes me because I don't feel like working. I had to resist not to lay hands on that person right under the chin. I appreciate it when we're able to help people who are incapacitated. It's a wonderful thing. But how many will agree with this? It's been badly abused in the United States of America. But when I grew up, I was taught you work to make a living. I started working before I graduated. I worked at home, of course, on the farm. But Dad would let us loose a little bit to go haul hay for some of the area farmers that had cows, and they would bale hay. And it wasn't the big round bales. It was the heavy square bales. And that's where I built my muscles, Brother Keith. I learned. That's whenever my chest was in full blossom. But when I got away from all that, my chest fell down to where all the drawers were working. And so I hauled hay, and it was a whopping 25 cents a bale. Man, I was making money. We had hauled, 100 bales out there in that 100 degree. Listen, it's hot in Arkansas, but I want to tell you it's hotter in Louisiana. They're closer to the Gulf, and there's a lot more moisture in the air. And we hauled hay out in those little straw fields. I'm telling you, throw that hay. It'd be all right when you're starting out on that trailer. Get that hay there. But when that hay stacks up, it's about 12 foot. You got to take that bale of hay, about 75, 80 pounds, hoist that dude up there. Got somebody stacking it. I tell you, you earned your 25 cents, brothers and sisters. And so that's how we earned our living. We learned to work to make money. And that's what was being taught. So we grow up with that mentality. We learn to work to earn a living. We work and earn a pay. We grow up with that thought in mind. But as I grew older, I come across something that really helped me in life. Because I found out if I don't work for more than I get paid, the chances are I will never get paid for more than I work for. We need to tell that to our kids. What does that mean? There's some things you have to do and should do in life that you're not getting paid for. God teaches us how to be a slave to freedom. It's easy to become a slave to so many different things in life. People become slaves to their appetites. Whether it's sports, hobbies, chemical substance, people become slaves to their own passions. Jesus said in Luke 4, he said this. He's reading out of the book of Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me, amen, to preach, to bring deliverance to the captives, to help the oppressed go free. He shared that as he was ministering at that time. He wanted to open the eyes of the blind so people could see. There's just times I need my eyes open because I get tunnel vision. Anybody here ever wrestle with tunnel vision? I just can't see some things. My wife, she really gets a little impatient with me sometimes when we're looking for things. She says, you can't find nothing. I said, honey, why did God give you to me to find my stuff? And she'll do it, sometimes reluctantly, not without a little preaching, but she does it. How many of you guys can stand a little preaching? Oh, I didn't get a whole. Let me check. Guys, you need a little preaching from your honey. Amen. Let me get out here. I'm not getting through. Guys, you need a little preaching from your honey. Well, I lost a lot. God mated us with the right person. Amen. They can see things we as guys can't see. Now, I know we see things they don't see, but you can't remind them of that. You let that go. I got a few of you on board. The rest of you just wondering how far. Well, never mind. Jesus wanted to bring eyesight to the blind, bring the gospel to the poor. He says in John 8:32, he said, whom the Son makes free is free. Everybody, would you say free? Boy, we are society. When they say free, it gets our attention, does it not? Read an ad, and when it says free, boop. I remember years ago that old show, My Favorite Martian. I know I'm dating myself, but I remember watching that. And that old boy, when certain things happen, them antennas, whoop. You put free on an ad. You put free in a storefront. You put free out there. And I'm telling you, so many people, their antennas go, whoop. Want to see what's free. I like free, but I understand nothing's really free. Somebody had to pay for it somewhere. Is that not true? I found out that the Son does make us free. However, it's one thing to quit a vice or a habit, but it's quite another to be delivered from the want of the desire to have what we're not supposed to have or indulge in. Do I have an amen? You see, I've witnessed some people are slaves. They are slaves to sin in a pen, like the penitentiary. They're locked in hell jail. They are chained in the hall of pain, captives in the pasture of illicit passions, blinded by the deceptive angel of light, sabotaged by Satan's espionage, hooked by the crook. In other words, imprisoned by things contained or connected to this human person. I become a slave to the things that God never intended me to be a slave to. Satan's the culprit. Satan is the instigator. And what he's after is to make me feel like I have no alternative but to do this or that, though it may be illegal, it may be unprofitable, it might be immoral, or it can just be shady gray. Satan puts me in a place to try to make me think I have no alternative, but I do. I found in this book called the Bible, whom the Son makes free is free. Bless God. I must let that revelation take a hold. I talked to a person one time who told me they had quit smoking, but it went for a while, and they told me, said, but if I had a cigarette 2 foot long today, I'd smoke every bit of it. He wasn't delivered. You can make up your mind to do things, but we have to find that freedom that the Lord talks about in His Word. Whom the Son makes free is... I know this might kind of rub some fur a little backwards, but amen, let's just go with what God has set up for us. We live below our privilege, and Satan wants to imprison us, amen, by things that just kind of blow my mind along the way. Our kids get hooked on chemical substance. Just one try won't hurt you, but much of it, it does. Let me tell you about one thing. One thing always opens the door for the second thing. I'm going to try it over here. One thing always opens the door for the second thing. You try something one time, now it's not the first time. You go again, it's different. Miss church one time, it can bother you. It can even make you feel bad. But by the time you miss it the second time, there's less conscience, there's less interference. Or, amen, maybe a guy is talking to a woman on the job and everything seems innocent, but if you're not careful, your guard drops, and the next thing you know, you're comparing this coworker to your spouse, and that's never good. One time leads to the second time. See, God sent Christ here not to make bad men good, but he come to make dead men live. Hallelujah. I was dead. You were dead. He come to make dead men live. He come to make captives free. And the Bible lets me know that you and I, even though we were dead in trespasses and sin in the book of Ephesians, yet he raises us up into eternal life. And Satan, he despises that, because watch this. Satan had it all. He had the favor of God. He had the beauty of God. He had all the choreographed arrangement of heaven's music, it seems like, what some have uncovered. I wasn't there, but that seems to be the indication. And yet, the Bible said he was perfect to the day iniquity was found in him. Now, you and I must realize God is God then, now, and forever. Nothing escapes him. Nothing gets by him. There is no such thing as something or someone getting over on God. God is always prepared. He's always ready. Satan's business is to try and steal you away from God, because he goofed away what God gave him. When devil's giving you problems about your life and what's going on, remind him of his future because of what he did in the past. Do you know the devil sinned when there wasn't a devil? The devil sinned when there wasn't a devil. So you and I have a little bit of an advantage. God has given us a way to come forward and to expel the things that try to hang on and attach themselves to our lives. Jesus came to create a community of the blood-bought lives that would no longer be a slave to the deeds of the flesh, to the cravings of humanity, but he wanted us to become debtors to the law of life in the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Holy Ghost. Would you say thank God for the Holy Ghost? Saints of God, we need the breath of God in our heart, working through our life. You remember what we said to you, what the Holy Ghost is. He's nothing more, he's nothing less, but he's every bit the voice of God. That's who the Holy Spirit is. He is the voice of God. When you're hearing God talk, that is the Holy Ghost. He is breathing the breath of God into your life, and he will use vocal cords if we'll give him vocal cords. That's why we're baptized in the Holy Ghost. God wants to employ my vocal cords. Speaking in tongues is wonderful, but what God is after is to employ my vocal cords, amen, for presenting the gospel, for sharing his love, for giving people something they need today, hallelujah, to give them something they're not paying me for, something I don't owe them, but I owe the master. So God wants to employ my vocal cords. How many know the air we're breathing right now is borrowed from God? Tell everybody, take a deep breath. You just took out a loan from God. Hallelujah. He loaned us the air we breathe. Man tries to control so many things. He kind of thinks he's God in some areas of humanity. But God gives us so much better understanding. I'm a debtor to the law of life in the Holy Ghost. After the birth of the church, one thing stood out. The Bible said they went from house to house, fellowshipping, blessing one another, getting together the information of what God was doing, how he was ministering, how he was moving, and the power that was working in everyone's life. God teaches us as we go along this trail. I need to hear what you have to say about your encounters with God. You need to hear what I have to say about my encounters with God. Because as much as God has given every one of us our own fingerprint, I want you to know God will give us every one a unique experience in him. As I've told you many times, when I was born again, God brought me in this shouting. He said to me in an audible voice in my left ear, shout. Amen. I jumped up from that altar 17 years of old. Amen. I was about like old Zach over here. Amen. Zach, stand up a minute. Do this, Zach. Yeah. Makes me remember where I used to be, brother. Hallelujah. I like to see that. Amen. Do things. Amen. That God set us up. I was in Brahms one day here not long ago, and I bought a couple of gallons of milk. Richard, amen, another football player not here this morning. He's here on Wednesday night. Big burly boy. I mean burly. I mean, I want him beside me when I walk downtown, baby. I got in that store. I'm checking out my milk. I got my 2 gallons of milk. I got it in that sack. He walked up. Oh, pastor, he loved me right there in front of everybody. I hugged him back. Let me get that for you, pastor. No, I carry my own milk. No, sir, I will carry your milk. I thought, my God, there's something good going on in our young generation today. Hallelujah. I can carry my milk. But, oh, listen, there might be people can carry their groceries. But what a blessing if you come along and say, hey, I want to get that for you today. Let me carry that to your car. You see, God wants us to understand everything in life doesn't come out in dollars and cents. Some things come to us in a completely other manner that God wants to show us the value, the riches, amen, of His glory, what it means to bless somebody else. And so as we move forward in life and we begin to learn some things, God shows me, He shows you what we are to do. By love, we serve our neighbors and our friends, our families. Mark chapter 10, verse 43. It shall not be so among you. Whoever desires to become great among you, they're going to be your servant. They shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Jesus pointed to His disciples. He said, I come to serve. And in the upper room, He gave them the communion. Then He gathered a pan of water and a towel. And He sat down. And He's fixing to wash their feet. And old Pete's always engaging mouth before brain gets real good. Not me, Lord, not me. I need to wash yours. No, Pete. You don't understand. I come to serve. I'm giving you an example. If I am your Lord and your master, as you so call me, He said, I want to show you what a Lord, what a master does. And I'm fixing to serve you. I'm going to wash your feet. No, sir, Lord, you just can't do. Son, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. If you don't let me serve you, then you will have no part with me. Hear me. If you don't let me serve you, you have no part with me. People want to do things for you. You may be capable of doing yourself. Don't write them off. Don't knock them out. Let them do it, because God says this is how the kingdom flourishes. I let old Richard carry my 2 big gallons of milk. Carried it right out to my car. Opened that door, put it right where it wanted. Hugged me again. Thank you, pastor. Woo! Boy, that blessed me up one side and down the other. You see, so easy for us to forget what servanthood really consists of. He said the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give His life a ransom for many. Paul laid out the framework for every believer when it comes to serving. 1 Corinthians 9:19. Though I am free from all men, I made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. He said that I might by all means win some, save some. Paul understood what it was to serve. You and I understand that. Some people have a dream of owning their own business. They think, man, if I had my own business, I'd have it made. Let me just tell you, amen, one of the greatest ways to learn servanthood is to own your own business, because you don't have one boss anymore. Everybody is your boss. Everybody. And if you have ever tried to please the public, you know what I'm talking about. Somebody is not going to like the way you do what you do. And they're going to test every fiber of the nerve you have for compassion. And that'll be the one that God is taking notes on. It's not the guy that comes up and slobbers all over and says, "Ooh, I just love you, love you. I love you too." He don't write that down. He said, it's easy for you to love people who love you back. He said, but the one that is your thorn in the side, God takes out his little notebook. Let's see how Brother Keith takes care of this one today. Well, I would have won that tournament, but you come by on your boat and made three waves, buddy. And I got the big one got off my hook. Or if you're a carpenter and you work on somebody's stuff and say, I didn't want it. I mean, you're all the way through. You're done. I didn't want it like that. Every molecule of my compassion and patience is going to become tested. Amen. I'll tell you, it would probably do everybody in church a good to be pastor for a Sunday. Come up here, Sister Kendricks. Come up here. Come up here. Aren't you happy?
Yeah.
We so happy, happy, happy. Happy, happy, happy. But you let my pocket get hanging out back here. Pastor to you, ma'am. And I walk around my pocket hanging out. She's sitting over there going, oh, God. Things you wouldn't think nothing about when you're in another position. Everything becomes illuminated. And so what God does, he puts us in places and in spots where things will challenge us and work on our nerve system. Not to bring me down, but he wants to bring me out. He doesn't want me to be a slave to all those emotions, those human feelings that can control me. He wants me to become a slave to the freedom that Jesus gave me. I'm free, bless God. I'll walk around with both my pockets out. Hallelujah. Now, I don't mean to do that mean, but I'm just saying. I think you understanding what our point, amen, of approach here is. What God set you up for, he set you up for success. And the way he gets us there is by taking us through things. So Paul said, I made myself a servant to all. Amen. That I might win. He didn't go around bragging about his rights, bragging about how good an apostle he was. He knew the secret to winning his peers was by example. 2 Corinthians 4 and 5, he said, For we do not preach ourselves. Have you ever been around preachers that preach themselves? Well, I'll tell you what I did back in 2001. Let me tell you what I did, blah, blah, blah. I prayed for so-and-so, and they were healed. I done this and this and done this, and I went over there. How many has ever heard people preach on themselves? The Lord convicted me of that such a long time ago. I try to be careful of this vocabulary that we use because it is, I want God to use my vocal cords, but I have to understand the responsibility that comes when God is employing my vocal cords. How many wants God to use your vocal cords? Amen. If you're cursing and using bad language, guess who's using your vocal cords? But you don't do that. But I have been around people who do that. We do not preach ourselves, but Christ, Jesus the Lord, ourselves, your bondservants for Jesus' sake. So, I bring us down to this point, if I can. I want to challenge us this morning. For this next week, do something nice, meaningful, good, productive, fruitful for somebody that you're not going to be compensated for. Jesus said, you invite people to your banquets, but they can pay you back. He said, I want you to invite people that do not have the means to invite you to their banquet. They don't have a banquet to invite. He said, I want you to do that. I want you to learn how to serve in your communities, to serve in your congregation, to serve those, amen, who I can speak to them through your life. One of the greatest things we were always blessed to do in the ministry as we serve God is to invite people out for a meal and just sit down and feed people, because when people eat, their spirit opens up. Do you know you can't eat without your spirit opening up? Unless you like indigestion, I mean. And I like to sit down with folks and have meals with them, so I'm going to start making a calendar. We're going to have lunch with everybody. Boy, I can see that didn't go over so good. I'll pay. Do something nice. And you can minister. You can share. You can love on people. And here's the thing I really love. You can listen to what people have to say from their heart. You get past the weather and past the news headline. You get past all that, and then you start learning some things about how to pray for people, how to minister to them, how to help them in their walk of life, and the things that they feel challenged by, and the things that they feel beset by. Because if you're around somebody just a little bit, you'll pick up on the things that's bugging them and that's worrying them and concerning them. And it's not that they're blabbermouth. No, sir, it's not that at all. It's just what's on the Bible said, out of the abundance of the heart, they're able to speak. And I love to have that sit down conversation, and I can't always do that. But that's why we're working like we are in a church, because God is raising you up in this body to be able to listen to people that you connect with, to listen to people who have challenges and difficulty in their life. You're listening as God employs your vocal cords and say, hey, I want to tell you, hey, we have a great church, and we have people who will love on you and will accept you just like you are, and let God handle the issues in your life. And people are looking for a place to belong and to fit. Are y'all hearing me? And they want to do it without a qualification. They want to do it without having to jump through hoops. They just want, just take me like I am. And listen, if you and I can catch them, God will skin them and clean them. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen, I wasn't a preacher the first week I was saved. But boy, I was boisterous. I was happy, happy, happy. God saved me. Woo! I'd sing to my cows. Y'all heard me say that. They loved it. They gave milk, Brother John, like I never thought they could give milk. Woo! I'm pulling that udder. Woo! When the road is called up yonder. Because I know when it's called, I'm going to be there. Old Bossy turned around, looked at me. I'm milking old Bossy. I milked old Pansy. Hey, amen. I milked Betsy. I milked them cows. 3-4 cows. And I like my brother and sister. They had to milk more than that. But I milked them. I'm saved. Bless God. I'm saved. And I'm glad to milk. I used to complain about those milk cows, but I quit complaining. I found there was a good reason for me to be here, and I'm going to milk them. Bless God. Mama, give me that bucket. Mama knew I got saved. I'm going to do something. See, Dad didn't pay us to milk the cows. Dad didn't pay us to do our chores. He only paid us for things that were optional, not necessary. And my dad would do this. He would pay us a little money to wash his car. Woo, my dad had a clean car, Bubba. We lived on a gravel road, and let me tell you, Dad, that car a little dusty. I think I can wash that. All right, son. I think he'd pay me $1. I think that's what he paid me every time I washed that car. Of course, we had well water, so I didn't realize all that well water I put on there made everything rust after a while. But if you're doing a job and you're doing something you don't get paid for, then you're going to find satisfaction like you can't measure. If you're in school, you do something you're not paid for or threatened to do, you're going to find satisfaction. Go to Walmart. I realize it'd be a little testy, but walk around Walmart. Find somebody you can bless and say, can I help you with your groceries out to your car? Don't be intrusive, because they're going to wonder, what do you want? They're going to wonder that. And you tell them, no, I'm a believer, and I just believe the Lord wants me to help you today, and I just want to be a blessing, that's all. No money, no thing. I don't want to know your address. Don't even want to know your name. I just want to tell you, I am just thankful to have breath in my lungs and muscles that can work, and I just want to be a blessing today. You know, people, I know they'll think you're strange, but let me tell you, they thought Jesus was very strange too. He healed the sick, even on the Sabbath. He made the lame walk. And when the disciples took over the ministry and they started doing things, it caused a lot of stir. It caused a lot of chaos. God wanted us to understand what it means to serve one another. A slave to freedom. What does that mean? Bless the name of Jesus, I've been made free. I don't have to work for money no more. I get to serve. And let me tell you, God will take care of it. We do funerals a lot. Y'all know that. That's what pastors get. And we've had funerals. I can't tell you how many funerals we've done, 200-300 funerals in our lifetime. I haven't kept up with it. It's been a lot. You know, some funerals, sometimes the family wants to give you an honorarium and bless you, and then sometimes they don't. And they'll ask me, how much we owe you, preacher? You owe me nothing. I just buried your spouse. I've just buried your child. You don't owe me anything. And I'll walk away, because that's not what we do it for. If people want to be a blessing, I'm not going to deny them that blessing, because Jesus said, I'm going to wash your feet, and if you don't let me wash your feet, you're not going to have anything to do in this ministry. So God's taught me. So I had this one thing happen. I'm going to tell you what happened. I done a series of funerals in the last few weeks. And as I did those funerals, same thing happened. We owe you anything, Brother John? No, you don't owe me nothing. You owe me nothing. And so we go on about our business, and next one comes up. Would you do the service for our low? Yes, I'll do that. We get up there, we do, we minister, we serve God. And I'll tell you what, and we walk away, and they give us enough offering in that one to last for three. You know what? I wound up doing three and got nothing. God works things. You see what I'm talking about? I don't do it. I don't do it for that. I do it because I want to serve a family. A family's hurting. They're going through a hard time. And I want to be there. I want to be that vessel that can encourage somebody. One of the greatest things God ever gave me. I was able to do this at the ball game the other night. I was at the ball game. But I was able to do this. Sit by a person. I met them. Got their name. First name. It was a lady. And she started telling me her story. See, she's not here this morning, I don't think. Told me she was going to come. I want to make sure. Started telling me her story. Had some challenges go on. Had a death in the family. Just had some big stuff go on. I said, well, I tell you, God gave me a scripture one time that really helped me. And I said, it's helped a lot of people. And I said, so I'm going to share it with you. So I pulled out my phone, got it up, brought it in. Amen. It was Isaiah 57, 58, 59, verse 1, verse 2, somewhere in there. I'd have to dig it up. But God says, he said, there's times whenever I take loved ones early to spare them from the disasters of life. So don't feel harsh about when you lose a loved one early. Now, I just paraphrase that for you. What I'm telling you is, there's times when you and I serve, it looks like we don't really have an opportunity, but just a little thing, sharing a scripture with somebody that can help them and bless them can be more than you and I can measure, more than you and I can really pull off and be what we could do any other way. It's how God sets us up for the blessing to be that vessel that he flows through. So I want to encourage you to be able to do that very thing. For this next 7 days, hey man, you don't have to do it a lot. You don't have to do it so, you just don't have to overload yourself with it. But I want you to do something that absolutely
will be a blessing. And the only compensation you're going to get, amen, is from God, that he will bless you. Here it is. It's Isaiah 57, verse 1. I'm going to read this to you. So this is NLT. Good people pass away. The godly often die before their time. But no one seems to care or wonder why, and no one seems to understand that God is protecting them from the evil to come. It's an awesome word from God's word. So if you're dealing with somebody that is troubled and they've lost a loved one prematurely in life, carry that with you. Isaiah 57. Read it from the New Living Translation. It words it that way so people can really grab and capture that. So here's the question. Are you a slave to something you're not happy about in your life and you'd like to be free from that? You'd rather be a person who is a slave to the freedoms that Jesus gives you, that you can serve. You're not on the payroll. You're not on the clock. I'm here to serve at the right opportunity, at the right moment. I can bless somebody and say, hey, can I just pray with you? Can I just love on you? And they may not take that terminology. You have to figure out the terminology that fits your situation the best. Amen. But I just want to be nice to you today, because maybe you've not had somebody be nice to you. And though it may raise suspicion, what you have to do, you have to outlive that suspicion in your life. And you can, because Christ is the one who rewards us. How many understands that? So, precious ones, being a slave to freedom just simply means I get to serve you without you asking, without somebody making me, without somebody requiring me. I get to be a blessing to you today. Isn't that marvelous? I get to do it all on my own. You know why? Because God has groomed me to be unselfish. Isn't that marvelous? If our churches get full of that kind of people, our churches will be overflowing. Is that not true? Just like this one. Keeps increasing, keeps growing. People keep coming by because somebody here was so specially nice and kind. That's why I'm here, because you were kind. You were nice. And you know what? After I got here, you still were. That's good. Now, girls, when you want to get married and that guy's real nice to you, just let me warn you, guys change after they get married. Sister Kendrick, be quiet. Guys, it's in their nature to change. They are conquer-oriented species, so when they conquer what they're after, they change and go get a new hunt. I'm sorry, Father. I didn't mean to offend anybody. But you guys know what I'm saying is true, do you not? I'm going to ask this question. How many guys in here has ever caught more than one fish? Can I see your hand? I'll get them up high. Bless you. How many guys in here has ever killed more than one deer? How come one wouldn't do you? Because you are a hunter and you are a fisher and one ain't enough. Now, I could ask the next question, but it'd cause a lot of problems. How many's got a wife and glad of it? There you go. So I want to encourage you to do for someone. Take the next 7 days. And the reason why I do that in 7 days, because it gives you a target. It's not open-ended. I want you to take the next 7 days, and I want you to focus. At Walmart or at the grocery store, at the gas station, wherever it is, do something for somebody, amen, that you're not getting paid for, you're not compelled to do. You just want to do it out of the kindness. And if it backlashes on you, just count it a blessing and say, thank you, Lord, okay? But here's the other thing. I want to pray with you. If you have found yourself in a struggle of life, a vice, a habit, or something that you just don't like it. It's not right. It's not what should be in your life. I want to pray for you this morning. Because I know, I understand. It's terrible to be a slave to things. Amen? How many knows who Little Debbie is? Little Debbie was my taskmaster for a long time. And she still floats around every once in a while. But you and I have to understand that nothing on this earth can be our dictator, our controller. I have to let that be severed from my life. So I want to pray with you and for you this morning if you're that type of person. Would you bow your heads? Master, we know there are so many things that the enemy comes at us and he's able to get a leverage on us and he's able to get advantage over us at times. But Father, today, your presence and your spirit has brought us to the place that we understand you absolutely are the great I am, and you give us victory over all these issues and matters that come at us in life and bring us down away from your glorious presence and your glorious indulgence in our worship and our praise. I want to be that person, God, that I continually give you praise, and I'm glad to be able to do it. And Lord, there are some under the sound of our voice right now that struggle with some things possibly, going through some challenges in their life. And I'm asking that you would minister to them at this very moment. I'm asking you, God, that you would help us. You would navigate us during this particular time. I need you, Father, at this moment, at this very juncture. I need you. I look to you, the author and the finisher, the great I am, the God who never, ever fails. I'm asking you to minister. I'm asking you to help us. In Jesus' mighty name. I'm going to get our musicians and Brother Keith to come back. Amen. Just for a moment. And well, I just want you with your heads bowed just for a moment, because I'm going to pray for you. I'm not here to embarrass not one human being in this building. I'm not here to write your name down on some kind of roster or some kind of diary anywhere. I just simply want to pray for you. Amen. And I want you that are here to know that there's people in this congregation that struggle with some things in their life. Maybe it's the neighbor next door who just keeps doing things that get on that nerve, or maybe it's a coworker who is abusive and their verbal language is so offensive and it just keeps gouging at you. And if not careful, it can bleed over on you. It's just so much that away. As God helps us to be slaves to freedom, I'm free. I don't have to do that. I don't have to act like a crazy person who's mad and angry. I don't have to act like a person who is immoral and indecent. I don't have to dress like the rest of the world. I can be decent and I can be modest and still be what God wants me to be and what society needs to see. I can be that person. All those things begin to come to the surface. Maybe something else has a grip and a vice around your physical person. God wants to make you, make me, make us free from every single one of those things. And so we're going to pray and ask God to minister. Family's going to pray for our family. Amen. Saints are going to pray for other saints. We're going to pray one for another. Hallelujah. They're going to give us, amen, a little music and a little bit of a song. I'm going to ask you to stand now. They're in place. Hallelujah. And I don't want to be offensive to anybody, but I'd like for you to pray for a person that's real close to you. If you don't have anybody real close to you, I'd ask you to move close to that person. I don't want to be offensive, but ladies, if you can pray for a lady, and guys, pray for a guy. Spouses, pray for the spouse. But some of you know what your spouse deals with and what somebody else goes through.
Than the air I
but I want you to pray for them right now. You know
than the
what
song I
tide needs to turn in their life. And it's the congregation that really does have power
more
with God.
Than
this congregation has power
and
with the Lord.
Time
so we're going to pray for our son, our daughter, our husband, or our wife, our friend, our fellow worshiper. We're going to pray for that person. We're going to ask God to minister. We're going to ask Him to take hold of this and let that freedom begin to reign. If Satan's been offering excuses to some,
for a good reason, not to read a Bible, not to pray at the time that they should, then that's going to be removed. God's going to deal with that right now. The Holy Spirit, He dealt with me so much the last 48 hours, how He wanted to move and how He wanted to come into this congregation to help this body with challenges that the enemy keeps trying to drag up and to sabotage your walk with God, to make you feel less than what you should in the presence of the Lord. So I'm going to ask you now, begin to pray for your friend, for your spouse, for your family member, for your neighbor. I ask you to pray, amen, for that person, amen. Maybe you feel led to untrack a little bit and to go over and pray for another one. That's perfectly in order right now if you want to do that. We're asking God, I'm not here to embarrass you, not here to make you exposed to anything. I'm here to love on you and to let you know God wants to help you in the challenge and in the things in life that keep coming at you to try to dissuade you from your dedicated walk to the Lord. God wants to help us today to arise and to be in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I'm praying for my brothers and my sisters. I'm praying for the moms. I'm praying for the widows and the widowers. I'm praying for people who have soaked their life into your care, and yet they meet challenges and they fight, Father, difficulties in their day-to-day walk. But yet today, you offer us an opportunity, God, that we might be that vessel that stands in the gap and we make up the hedge. Oh, we declare your goodness. And Lord, we expound upon your mercies and we share it with somebody else that may be fighting loneliness, fighting secularism, God. They feel isolated from all of society in the middle of a crowd. I'm asking you to minister to them. I'm asking you to take hold, God, of the necessities that they have right now. I come against every vice, Father, every innate nature that Satan tries to drag up to control that vessel. And I speak, Father, into your life, Master, to move with the word into their life. Now, I give myself for the word to flow through. And we break every chain. We break every fetter that would cause a person to stumble and to fall back and not to feel the confidence and to know the direction that you lay out in front of them. It's in Jesus' mighty and glorious name, Father. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Because you offer us what we can obtain no other way, no other measure, no other place. In the name of Jesus Christ, my Father, my God, my Redeemer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
More than this song, hallelujah. I see.
I want to bless you.
Next heartbeat.
My King. Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Now I want to say to our hearts, if I can have your attention now for just a moment. Satan has been around how many years, and you've been around how many years? I want to tell you, you'll never outfox him. Can't outfox the devil. I am not quite 70 years old. Some of you are less than that. Some of you are a little more than that. But you've never come to the place where you'll have experience in your life that Satan has. The only way Satan can ever be beat is that God, who's been around longer than the devil, can give you and I the plan to overcome him. Amen? Amen. So I want you to know, don't have confidence in yourself. You have to have your confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. He has to carry you. God, how do I deal with this? And he will give you the formula. I've helped people over the course of time, and I'll just use this one thing. We've had people in our past that dealt with smoking, and they wanted to be loose from that. I said, if you want to be free, let me know. I will help you. And we've done is things like we'd fast 3 days. I know that's a little challenging, but we've seen God break that yoke. We've seen people have trouble with other issues in their life. Amen. I'll tell you something that's just as bad, and that's gossiping. How many knows that's a terrible habit to have? Amen. Hallelujah. I want to tell you a secret, so don't tell nobody.
That's the famous words of a gossiper. Thank you, Father, for that. I love you, church. You are moving forward. You're gaining ground. Don't back up. Tell the devil, I am not a slave to you anymore, sir. I'm not following your agenda anymore. I have a brand new agenda now. I'm following, and it's laid out by the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to serve somebody this week. I'm going to serve somebody even today. Amen. Do that. We were at a restaurant somewhere not long ago, and we got to pay, and then the server said, hey, your meal's already taken care of. I said, you got to be kidding me. He said, no. I said, who did it? He said, I don't know. I want to be a blessing. Amen? Amen. Pick somebody out. If you're eating, just pick it out. Amen. It might be the one whose bill's $100, but that's all right. Just be a blessing and let God use you. Amen. Love you, church. I know it's a holiday weekend. Please be careful if you're traveling. Wednesday night, we're back here again, 7 o'clock. We're looking for the manifestation of God. Amen, one more time. But I believe God has impacted somebody's life in here this morning in a very strong and powerful way. You don't have to be a slave to the things of this world. You become a slave to the things of God. Amen. I am his bondservant. How many's glad you're his bondservant? Amen. Before we depart, does anybody need special prayer? We'll anoint you all. We'll pray for you. We'll do what the Scripture says. That is the way you serve God. You do what he says in the Bible. Amen. Hallelujah. Everybody ready to go to heaven? Everybody ready to do something good for another person? If y'all don't have nobody, my name is John Kendricks, K-I-N. I'm kidding a little bit. Y'all are a blessing. You are a blessing. All right. Love you. God bless you. In Jesus' name, Father, I pray your blessing upon every family in this room today. Father, that you will be able to work through each one's lives, employing each set of vocal cords to heap blessings upon co-workers, neighbors, and relatives. You are the one who gives us what we need to say. You promised it in the Scriptures. Therefore, we take to heart those very thoughts and thank you for them. May your power of spirit in keeping safe every heart, every life, every family be upon each one of my brothers and sisters. It's in Jesus' glorious and mighty name. And everybody saying, shake hands with each other. God bless you in the name of the Lord.